thanks very much for everyone for attending. I have sad news to start the talk, in that we had invited a Turkish anarchist from the DAF over to speak, and we heard on Tuesday that his visa had been refused and he was asked to reapply, and obviously that meant that there wasn't enough time for him to come and talk to us. We do have Paul Bowman, who's a long-time anarchist, WSM supporter, and a frequent visitor to Turkey, who's just returned from Kurdistan. So he's going to talk about his long-term interest in the area and in these issues. And there is also a Kurdish speaker that I've been told is on its way, so may not arrive in time to speak. Hussein from the Turkish anarchist has sent a statement which he asked to be read out to the meeting. So Mark's going to read that statement. So we'll start with that.
We salute all our comrades organising and participating in the book fair and comrades in WSM as part of the solidarity relationship which is established and intensifying in a time when we, the oppressed, suffering economically and socially and being destroyed in the wars each and every day. The Rojava revolution that you showed solidarity for from far end of Ireland has reached a point that is most hope-inspiring, along with the victory of Kobani. We are getting more encouraged every day with the hope that the land of Rojava will be reconstructed away from capitalism, states and all kind of authoritarian relationships. We have all witnessed Kobani people's self-organised struggle for life against ISIS, against Turkish state, against the ones with capitalist interests, against misinformation by the media. As revolutionary anarchists, aware of our historical responsibilities in a time when the wars divide the peoples in every geography from Ukraine to Egypt, we are part of the solidarity that destroyed the borders. We were part of the struggle for freedom against the wars created for interests of states and capitalists. We were a barricade of the line of resistance that didn't let ISIS pass. The fabricated violence that neither the states with big armies nor the super state institutions could stop. With our insisting embrace of the Kobani resistance, we became a response to the ones saying Kobani is about to fail, and the ones seeing Kobani as a fantasy. We made all this with our anarchist solidarity created in this period. Comrades in different geographies have shown our voice, power, determination, hope and conviction. Along with the history of anarchism, the solidarity which was realised for Durruti and Ascaso by their comrades in Fora, or was realised by Emma for her comrades in Japan convicted to execution, have shown us once again, solidarity is our biggest weapon. Now the people of Rojava will reconstruct life. Life will be organised again, keeping a distance from authorities. Rojava revolution, which is now more visible owing to the Kobani resistance, will not be deprived of this solidarity. Like Comrade Durruti said, the ones who are the least afraid of the ruins will build the whole world again. We appreciate the efforts of we appreciate the efforts of anarchist organisations, groups and individuals from all around the world for organising and growing the network of solidarity with us as we experienced all this together. We conducted something, getting involved and interpreting current political reality from an anarchist perspective. In this period, there have been many texts with different assessments published on the matter among anarchist organisations and groups. Many comrades from different regions came to Kobani and border villages and they have made assessments. The momentum that the anarchist movement gained in this process by solidarity looks promising. We think that anarchism should be the dynamo of struggles of the oppressed peoples in all regions. It's our tradition. We are aware that for the anarchist movement to achieve this, it needs to show the courage to say its word on the political reality with the solidarity and organisation shown in this process. As revolutionary anarchist action, with this perspective, we are raising our struggle against all forms of authority and working for the anarchist movement to become a tradition in our region. Like the struggle that our comrades in worker solidarity movement in the far end of Europe, the organised struggle you're fighting there is making us powerful. We hope our organised struggle in this part of the world makes you powerful. Now the anniversary of the Haymarket massacre, in which 5 anarchist comrades were murdered, is approaching, which is one of the most important dates of the anarchist movement. The state has banned, as the Turkish state has banned, May Day. No demonstrations are permitted. We are not afraid, just like our comrades in 1886, who rose the principle of 8 hours a day against all inhibitions of the states and the bosses. Taksim Square, which the state is closing with special security precautions since the Taksim Gezi uprising, is also important for the workers' struggle of this land we live in. Closing Taksim Square, which saw bloody May Day, is an ideological position. Despite the efforts of the state and bosses, we are not afraid of fighting, as it says on the posters we posted all over Istanbul, and we know that May Day is a fight. We salute all comrades giving the struggle of socialising anarchism with the passion of social revolution, courage and determination. It's important to remember the slogan that our comrades raised in the 2008 revolt in Greece: our century is starting now, and the socialised slogan of Taksim Gezi uprising: this is just a beginning, the struggle continues. Long live the revolution, long live anarchism, from the Revolutionary Anarchist Action DAF in Turkey.
Thanks very much, Mark. Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to hand over to Paul, who's going to talk for maybe 20, 25 minutes, and after that we'll open up to the floor for any questions or discussion.
Okay, let me just start my clock here so I can keep an eye on what I'm doing. Hi, welcome to the talk. Thank you all for coming along. My name is Paul. As you can tell, I'm neither Kurdish nor a woman, so that immediately puts me in a slightly difficult position for giving you answers to the questions about this talk. And basically what I'm going to try and do is not so much give you answers as to give you enough information so that you can begin to find the questions that you really want to know the answers to. Because sometimes in a topic, if you don't know anything about it, you don't even know what questions to ask. So hopefully by the time we get through this and we have some dialogue at the end, well, not the end, because the dialogue will actually be the most important bit in some senses, is to start teasing out the questions that are important to us here in Ireland in relation to what's happening in Rojava. So, first of all, I should probably explain what Rojava is. Rojava is Kurdish for west. So it's western Kurdistan, which is essentially in northern Syria. So it's the bit of the Mesopotamian plains that come out from the Taurus Mountains. It's quite a fertile area. It's historically, since the beginning of civilization, been associated with growing wheat and pasturage and so on. In the context of the Syrian civil war, in 2012, essentially the organized forces of Kurdish resistance in Syria took over 3 areas in northern Syria, 3 cantons that the Syrian state withdrew from, partly just because the Syrian state was too busy fighting on other fronts. And so they have established their own independence, autonomy, very precarious one, for the last 3 years. And most people were not aware of this until last year, when ISIS, Daesh, attacked the canton, the middle canton of Kobane, and Kobane became a thing on the news that people had heard about. And I guess that's probably why a lot of you are here. So I'm going to try and explain some of the background to that. And the first question is, are we talking... The title of the talk is A Revolution in Rojava. Now, the question that we're asking, I suppose, is this simply resistance or revolution? If it was resistance to ISIS, to the state oppression of Turkey, Syria, and so on and so forth, it was simply a Kurdish national liberation struggle, it would in itself be worth supporting. But that's not the topic of this talk. The reason this talk is entitled The Revolution of Rojava is because something we believe, something else is happening here, something quite interesting. And that's basically what we're going to explore here. So, people have heard the term Rojava Revolution. People have heard that there's some kind of relationship to anarchism or something like that. People have heard there's some kind of relation to feminism or something like that. So the first question has become, is this an anarchist revolution? Or is this a women's revolution, as being sometimes said? I'm going to put the question of whether this is an anarchist revolution slightly to one side. And the theme that I'm going to explore is this a women's revolution? Not exactly. There is a women's revolution involved in the Rojava revolution, but it's kind of the revolution within the revolution, which sounds a little bit complicated, but I'm hopefully going to explain what I mean by that. So the first thing is that Kurds have been ignored for a long time. There's been a brutal war in the Turkish area of Kurdistan since the 1980s up until the present day, in which 40,000 people have been killed and millions have been driven out of their villages. There's been a scorched earth policy by the Turkish state, particularly in the 90s, that has driven peasants from their villages, that has killed the livestock of peasants and nomads alike, and driven Kurds from the countryside into the urban centers. So a place like Diyarbakir, where I was a few weeks back for the Kurdish New Year, was not originally a Kurdish majority city until about 10 or 15 years ago. It is now a Kurdish majority city because it is now full of all the people that have been driven off the land and driven into the neighborhoods and slums, if you like, of Diyarbakir. So there has been, what I want to say is there's been, because of the fact that the Kurds have been ignored for a long time, and because of the struggle they've been involved with, has been a very brutal one, they can be forgiven for wanting to get publicity by any means necessary. And if by any means necessary for getting attention and publicity means that they put around the social media pictures of pretty women with guns, then they're going to do it. But that is not what makes a women's revolution. It's fine, it's not fine, that there is a fetishism for having pictures of Middle Eastern women with guns because it interferes with a certain kind of prejudices we have. It's fetishism, it's titillation, etc. But that is not what is the content of this revolution. The revolution has three aspects, which are political, economic, and social. And it's the social part of the revolution that I have to talk about, and which sort of underpins and makes possible the other three corners of the revolution. By economic, let me just say in passing that the areas of Kobane and Jazeera, which are two of the cantons. Efrin is sort of mountains, which is a slightly different category. But Jazeera and Kobane canton are wheat growing areas, so they're very rich agricultural land. Historically, most of this land has been owned by supporters of the Syrian regime. After 2012 happened and the regime was effectively evicted from these areas, of course, a lot of those landowners buggered off, and which meant that effectively people in those areas have taken over that land, and that land has been socialized, which is to say it has been put in control of the cooperatives and of the political structures of the people that live there to be farmed collectively and for the products of that agricultural activity to be used in a non-market way, that is to say, to be distributed amongst the people of the area and so on. So the details, obviously, were a bit sketchy on because this is a war zone. It's quite hard to get people in and out. Accounting is a bit difficult because if you're surrounded by people that want to kill you and want to destroy your economy, obviously you have to be a little bit discreet about what's happening. But there is certainly an economic aspect to the revolution in Rojava that is very interesting from anybody coming from a left-wing or socialist or anarchist kind of background. The political aspect of the revolution is in many ways relating to what the Zapatistas did in Mexico back in the early 90s, and we're going to come back to that in a minute. But it's the social aspect of things that is going to unlock this question of what do I mean by the women's revolution is the revolution within the revolution in Rojava. I'm going to go slightly left field here and situate where we are. Kurdistan is mainly mountains. You can't talk about Kurds without talking about mountains. And we're talking the eastern Taurus Mountains and the Zagros Mountains that run down the western side of Iran. And these mountains are actually part of a chain that traverses the whole of the Eurasian continent, which is the Alpine Belt. I grew up in part of this chain in Switzerland. But there are a number of peoples along these mountainous things that have quite diverse cultures, from Basques at one end to Pashtuns at the other. But the very fact of living in the mountains imposes certain economic necessities on you in terms of subsistence. There's a limited amount that you can grow in the valleys. There is high pasture that is inaccessible at wintertime, but is accessible during the summer. So from Basque through Switzerland, through the Greeks, through the Kurds, the Baluchis, the Pashtuns, etc., there has been this thing of moving livestock around. And transhumance, where you live in the valley and you go up to the same pasture every year, and then something that's called by an awkward name, semi-nomadism, which is where people are traveling quite long distances, up to hundreds of miles on an annual cycle with their livestock. And nomadism is this what is sometimes called black tent culture, because there's this particular type of black tent that you will see from the Bedouin right through to Afghanistan, all through the Zagros chain, etc., that is common to this culture of the people that when they are following their livestock through the mountainous terrain, they spend at least part of their lives in these tents. Nomadism is important because, first of all, when we talk about nomads, nomads are very poorly studied. Around the universities of the world, there are departments of women's studies, there are departments of black studies, etc. There are no departments of nomad studies. Nomads don't count in a lot of people's way of seeing the view, and that's left-wing as well as right-wing, you know. The people who worship at the altar of the development of the forces of production do not see nomads as people with a history. So we think of nomads as the horse nomads of the Eurasian steppe, or we think of people as the desert nomads of the camels and so on. The nomads of the mountain belt are the goat nomads, if you like, goats, sheep, cattle. And nonetheless, they have a society. And the thing about nomadic society, which is tribal society, is that many people say like the Pashtuns, which is where my study originally began before I, for political reasons, became involved with looking at Kurdish society. It has, many people say, it's a stateless society, which is true. I say it's a classless society, which in a certain way is true. And, you know, if you're coming from a naive anarchist background and say, well, if it's stateless and classless, it must be a free society. It's like, well, that's not quite true, because this society has a structure. And it is a tribal structure. And generally, I don't know of any exceptions to this, it is a patriarchal structure as well. And we need to understand this structure in order to understand why the Kurdish movement is attempting to do what it's doing. So, in relation to the Rojava struggle, the Rojava struggle does not begin in Rojava in a sense. The Rojava struggle is part of the PKK struggle in Turkey from the 1980s up until the present day. Obviously, they don't limit themselves to Turkey. They have people in northern Syria. They have people in northern Iraq as well, although northern Iraq is mainly dominated by other forces. And so they have been... They waged initially a very standard sort of, you know, Marxist, Leninist, Maoist style national liberation struggle in the 1980s and 1990s. And their ideology has developed a little bit since that time into something quite different from where they started from. Not by having some kind of ideological light bulb moment, but just because of the problems that they ran into. So, within this struggle then that has led up to the Rojava Revolution, there are things that have changed and there are things that are invariant. The invariant parts are the enemy, the Turkish state. They're still the brutal, fascistic machine that they ever were. And that stuff doesn't go away. The things that have changed, however, the society has changed, as I mentioned previously. The effect of the war, particularly in the 80s and particularly in the 90s, means that you have had this sort of primitive accumulation effect, if you like, through deliberate violence of the Turkish state, driving peasants and nomads off the land and into the cities. So that's a major, you know, thing that has happened to Kurdish society within the last 20 years. So it's an enormous kind of crash stop social transformation that's happened. The other thing that's happened is a change of understanding of the PKK as to what it is they're trying to do, or the structures of Kurdish society they started in. That you can see this in the change of the language, that in 1979, one of their first military operations was they launched a war on feudalism by assassinating one of the, or attempting to assassinate, they failed, one of the major tribal leaders who was in an alliance with the Turkish state, Mehmet Bucak. And they soon discovered that, because they thought, well, you know, this guy's lording over his peasants, you know, we'll take him out, the peasants will side with us and revolt against the hated landlord class, etc., because this is feudalism. They discovered, after they failed their assassination attempt, that he then mobilized his entire tribal confederation against them, and not just the landowners, the whole fucking tribe. And they went, oh, shit. So they then found themselves having to make alliance with the tribal enemies of the Bucak tribe, and eventually they got dragged into the tribal warfare system, because the tribal system is a warfare system. So the very thing that they thought they were attacking, they end up getting just absorbed into. So the language moves from the war on feudalism of 1979 to the term that they mostly use nowadays is what they're finding is the tribal feudal system. They've accepted that tribalism is actually a major feature of Kurdish society. The fact they didn't know this from the start, you have to understand that the social composition of the original PKK Corps was the non-tribal Kurds from the cities who were sent to universities to become educated, to become sort of the technocrats of the Turkish state in the future, who then got into leftist politics and picked up these mad fucking Maoist ideas like, hey, let's start a revolution, it'll be grand. So they've had to change their model of what the structure of the society that they're attempting to change. The society itself, as I said, has also changed because of the war, because of this urbanization, proletarianization thing. And then this comes to the core of what we need to understand when we're looking at what is the content of this struggle. And we need to get away from, this is going to sound a technical term, this idea of history as a train track, of a unilinear history, that everybody's basically on the same train track. Back in the Enlightenment, in the early late 18th century, early 19th century, there's a very bourgeois model of history of stages, that there was hunter-gatherers, and then there was pastoralists, and then there was agriculture feudalism, and then there was commerce and capitalism. Bang, 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 bang. Now, there's also a kind of a leftist version of that with a little bit of Marxist language on top, but it's essentially the same idea. You know, hunter-gatherers, pastoralists, peasants and lords, capitalism, bang. And this is not just, this is a very common theme in history. Whenever anybody uses the term backwards in relation to a culture and economy, they're thinking of this train track. You know, backwards, you're behind us, you're in front of us. Backwards advance. You know, it's on a line, therefore, that's how people think about history. And we need to get out of that mentality. There's nothing backwards about Kurdish society, even though it has tribalism. And most of all, we have to get out of this lazy idea, because behind this idea of a train track history is modernization theory, which is the idea, sure, once everybody goes into the cities and then there's money and capitalism, stuff like that, all of that old stuff, that tribalism stuff, will just fade away and everybody will become like us. It's like, no, that's not going to happen. There's nothing automatic about social change. Social change does not happen just because there's Coca-Cola and Big Macs. So, and this is very true in relation to tribalism within Kurdish culture, although, of course, not all Kurds are tribal, and not all people in Kurdish society are Kurdish, by the way. For a long time in the cities, for centuries, there have been other ethnicities, Syriacs, Aramaeans, Armenians, Greeks, Jews, etc., who have been part of the commercial network that make Kurdish society as a whole function. So not everybody in the PKK, for example, would be Kurdish. You would also find Armenians and other types of ethnicities as well. So the tribalism thing is important. It's difficult for me to try and give you a quick 2-minute explanation of the structure. But essentially, it is a patriarchal structure where you're, what matters is being the son of your father, and that you owe him your allegiance when it comes to fighting, and that he owes his allegiance to his father, and so on. It's this idea of creating a perfect patrilineal hierarchy without divided loyalties. And what that means is that there's a strong incentive for you as a man to marry your father's brother's daughter. And as a woman, there's a strong incentive for you to marry your father's brother's son, your patrilineal first cousin. And this is reinforced in many ways, in many Middle Eastern cultures, including Kurdish one. Quite often, if you're a woman, your patrilineal cousin has the right of first refusal. That is to say, you're actually not allowed to marry anybody unless he says it's okay. There is bride price as well. There are two different types of sort of patriarchal culture. One of them is dowry, where the family with the daughter pays the money to the family with the son. The bride price is where the family with the son pays the money to the family with the daughter. But in both cases, obviously, there's a strong incentive to try and keep marriage within the family so that you don't lose the land or the money. There's also the whole point of trying to keep this line clear without any cross-fertilization is so there are no divided loyalties when it becomes time to fight. Because most of tribalism is essentially around blood feuds. It's all about the feuds, really. And that's... It's difficult for me to explain in a very short time, but essentially tribalism is about finding sources of authority in a stateless society that can settle a dispute between families, between lineages. And the way you do that is by having someone further up the pyramid who can bring you together and go like, listen, guys, you need to sort this out. You need to give them that as compensation, blah, blah, blah. Be it money or women, because women are traded as compensation as well in this system. And this system comes from the nomadic background, but it has made the transfer quite successfully to settled peasant agriculture as well, and it's now made the transition quite successfully to urbanized proletarian city-dwelling, capitalist-dwelling as well. So this is not a structure that automatically disappears with the transition to capitalism. This is a structure that is there, and it dominates people's lives. It dominates women's lives, of course, because of the problems of forced marriage, of domestic violence, of rape culture that goes with it. The whole ethos of this system is underpinned by what's called honor, but the word is misleading. The word in Kurdistan and most of the Middle East is namus, and in India it's izzat. But this is where you get the honor is not an individual thing, it's a family thing. But it is based on the body of women. So therefore, the violation of the chastity of a woman within the family disgraces the honor of that family, and therefore the only way to get rid of that honor, that stain upon your honor, is to spill blood, either to kill the women involved or to kill the perpetrators, or preferably both. So this system of tribalism, which is about trying to manage blood feuds, also produces the very thing that it's trying to manage. Tribalism produces the blood feuds that it exists to manage, if you like. And that is a social problem. Ethically, politically, of course, it's horrendously oppressive to women. It's actually not brilliant for men either, because it means that a lot of the time you're not doing what you want to do, you're doing what you're being told to do because of these duties and honors and stuff like this. So it's quite an oppressive system to live within, even though there isn't a state out there creating this oppression. There isn't, you know, an external authority. This is an oppression of obligations and limits and boundaries that is created by the culture that you live within, by the way that everybody else sees you and behaves towards you. And that's difficult enough. It creates violence. There's no question about it. And I've been talking about this sort of stuff before, and Dermot, who was around earlier, who works with Irish travelers, going like, you know, a lot of what you're saying has resonances for me. So this is, again, this culture is not unique to Kurds, because you will also find it throughout Turkey, throughout the Arab world, Persia, as I say, up to the Pashtuns in Afghanistan and so on. this culture is hard enough when you're in a dispersed area, when you're nomads. If you're a nomad, you have a beef with a family where someone's going to get killed, you move. You have a spatial fix. If you're in a village, you have a beef with a family, you run away to another village that's controlled by a tribe that's not allied to your tribe. So when you're dispersed, you can move around. When all of a sudden there's 2 million of you living cheek and jowl within an urban environment where there's nowhere to run to and nowhere to hide, this becomes the ingredients of a major social catastrophe if it's not controlled. So this is one of the reasons why tribalism, which has never really been concretely tackled by most of the other political forces in the region, has become a pressing issue. Initially led by the women within the PKK, and now since the mid-2000s has actually, they have managed to get it on the agenda, if you like, to be adopted in a change of what this movement is doing. Running out of time very quickly. I need to briefly mention A Tale of Two Prisons. When I was in Diyarbakir, we were headed to the New Year Festival in Nowruz on the 21st of March, which was something there were 2 million people going to, by the way. And this, to give you some idea of the scale of this movement, this not, you know, when I talk about the PKK, I'm also talking about a social movement of people, most of whom are not in any way formally involved with the party, but is a mass movement of millions of people. So there's 2 million people going to this event, you know, which has all the martyrs from Kobani up on the wall, you know, and it's got the Kurdish flags and the YPJ flags and all the rest of it. This is not a non-political event by any stretch of the imagination. But while we were on the bus going up to the big sort of park outside of town, which was the only space big enough to hold this number of people, everybody, you know, you're on a crowded Dolmush minibus, lots of people all done up in their best duds because it's festival day, chatting away happily, you know, everyone's in a good mood. And then at a certain point in our journey on the bus, sort of conversation dies down a bit and people tense up. And then someone starts singing, and everybody starts singing. And they're singing guerrilla songs, and they're pushing their fists out the window at the building that we're passing by, because the building that we're passing by is Diyarbakir Prison. And Diyarbakir Prison has a very important part to play in the formation of this movement, because this was, it's a long history prison, but became a military prison in 1978, and then the first wave of arrests in 1980 became a torture center where, sorry, trigger warning, but the systematic use of torture and rape and so on was used in an attempt to psychologically destroy the men and women who were incarcerated in this hell. And that, within that camp, and again, the whole point of telling you about namus, honor, tribalism, and stuff like that is to try and get you to understand that rape used as a psychological tactic is of course destructive in any culture, but this is deliberately attempting to leverage the culture of tribalism, that if you are raped, you become a non-person, a person of dishonor, a person who cannot be married, cannot have a life. And in attempt to destroy both the men and the women in those prisons, and really the strength of the women's movement within the PKK comes from this experience, particularly led by the OC, I suppose, of the women's wing in the prison, a woman called Sakin Jansiz, who's a very important person in this political turn that we talked about, from the old style sort of Maoist national liberation struggle to the new turn, which is social change now, if you like. And from out of the women's wing of this prison in the 80s, in the 90s, they formed, they were already involved in the party and in the guerrilla. And then in 1994, about 6 months after the Zapatista uprising, they formed, they demanded their own command within the army, that they be given autonomous command, be able to command themselves, and they set up their own party, which is today the Kajetka, the Kurdish Women's Party, which is a part of the KCK, Kajetka, which is the Kurdish Communities Union, which, again, I don't have time to go into all the structures. Maybe we can pick that up later if people are interested. But this women's wing of the party, which in the 90s grew to become a third of the party, but a vital section of the party without which they could not have endured, they saw the Zapatistas' revolutionary law on women that was announced on the uprising, the 1st of January 1994, which says we wish to ban forced marriages, we wish to ban, I don't have the thing in front of me, the 10-point program, which is very clear, very precise, but is clearly talking about the problems of women in a tribal society like that of South Mexico, and one that the Kurdish women looked at and went, this is our program. And they have then fought for the last 21 years to get that program on the agenda of the party and the movement as a whole. And they succeeded in 2004, where the party took the turn towards democratic confederalism and democratic autonomy. Now, there's political and economic aspects to the program for democratic confederalism and democratic autonomy as well. One of them is the abandonment of the attempt to set up an independent Kurdistan by militarily defeating the states of Turkey, Syria, Iraq, and Iran. And that's partly just a numerical thing, that they don't have the force of things. So it's partly also an acceptance that the problem of tribalism allows for the fact that the Kurds have been used as a plaything by the differing imperialist powers in the region for the last 100 years or so. For many centuries, the Kurdish social structure allowed them to become independent of the big empires surrounding them. However, in the last 100 or so years, their structure has been used against them by different imperialist powers buying off the loyalty of different tribes. And this has been the curse of the Kurds, if you like, for the last, in the modern era. Finally, I said a tale of two prisons. The other prison, of course, was an American one set up in Iraq called Camp Burak, or I can't remember the name exactly, which is where the other pole of the contradiction comes from ISIS, who are the enemy that made Kobane the name it is today. And what is interesting in the fact that the Syrian civil war has led to what is now a confrontation between the PKK and ISIS is that both of these sides have an ideology and a determination that was formed in the hell of these prisons. But all of the other forces in the area that have been created through the pouring of money into tribal structures to buy loyalty, when war came, it turns out that people whose loyalty is bought but don't have any particular other belief apart from liking the money, they don't fight so well. You know, when ISIS came, the Iraqi army ran away because the Iraqi army were really only there for the money. So why get killed for that? And this is why the peculiar, because obviously people ask, you know, Kobane could not have stood had it not been for the fact that the U.S. decided to send in the Air Force to support the fighters on the ground. Why did they do this? Well, because they discovered that the other pole of the contradiction, ISIS, was more frightening than the PKK, who they still officially say is terrorists. Turkey, Erdogan says, yeah, for me there is no difference between the PKK and ISIS, they are the same. Eventually the US went, well, we don't agree. So, but in both cases, these forces with a strong ideology are the ones that are left standing when the war has burned away, if you like, the non-ideological forces. So in any case, in the situation of this war, which is not going away and is not going to remain contained in this little area, we have to take a position. All right, maybe we don't have to take a position. I think we do. I think this war matters, and not just because, you know, ISIS are a sort of a bogeyman picture of everything that's bad, but because the side that we're interested in, the democratic autonomy side, if you like, has something very interesting, not just for the Kurds, but also for anybody, for all the people in the region who have similar social challenges of a tribally dominated society in a collision course with modernity and capitalism, which is actually quite a lot of people in the region. Finally, I realize I've been talking for far too long. I'm going to come to the... Hopefully, I've begun to outline some of the areas about the questions that we need to ask to learn more. So, which brings me to the big question, of course, is like, what can we do? What does this mean to us here in Ireland? What can we do? We need to learn more. We need to ask questions. Walking, we ask questions, as Apatista said. We need to understand that Kurdish society and also Middle Eastern society is different from the society that we live in, although of course there are many things that are the same as well. But we need to be able to cope with that to engage with that difference in a way that avoids the twin perils of being either Eurocentric, which is say, sure, differences don't matter, you know, everyone's really like us, except just with, you know, they have mosques and shit. Or in an Orientalist kind of way, which is the other pole of the thing of going like, oh, it's, you know, they're really different and this is all very essential and this makes them, you know, it means they don't, you know, want food, love and family and stuff the same way that everybody does. So we have to avoid these two traps, if you like, of Eurocentrism and Orientalism, and still less Islamophobia. There's one thing I forgot to mention. In relation to tribalism, honor killings, the patriarch, all of this sort of stuff, this is not unique to Muslim Kurds by any means. You know, Yazidis, Christians, Armenians, etc., even Jews in the area, they have this same culture. And this culture is, in fact, way older than any of the religions around. Because we're talking... of this region, this is where wheat was domesticated on the slopes of Mount Karakadak. A few miles away is a place called Göbekli Tepe, which is a monolithic site that dates from before agriculture was invented, from 12,000 years ago. So civilization happened before agriculture, which completely reverses any of the ideas that we had. This is the area where the goat, the first animal to be domesticated was the goat, was domesticated in the Zagros Mountains. So the Neolithic Revolution happened in what we now call Kurdistan. So this culture of people, tribes, navigating their goats around the mountains, fighting each other over land and for family, honor, blood, and so on, has been going on for at least 8,000 years. You know? We're not talking about, and this is, you know, Islam, Christianity, Judaism, and so on, this is all Johnny-come-lately stuff, really. This has nothing to do with religion. This culture is going on for a long time. And this is why changing this culture and the need for a change of this culture so that people can carry on is a revolutionary task. It is one that has been begun by the KJK and its various forces. It, of course, still exists in a state of precarity. There are many forces around in the region and internationally which could crush us. But nonetheless, it's an exciting development. It's new, it's original, it's unique, and it's something that we should pay attention to. And in terms of what we could do, if anybody's interested in putting their names down for having further meetings for things that we can do in terms of forming a solidarity organization here in Ireland, because I think they're very interesting things for us to learn and to propagate as well. So I'm going to shut up there. Thank you.
Thanks, Paul. That was incredibly informative. I'm just going to open it to the floor for any discussions, questions. Wow, loads of these. So what I'll do is I'll take maybe four questions in a row, or discussions. We've also got going around some feedback forms. If people could fill them in either now or after the meeting or at the end of the day, they're really useful for us in trying to arrange the book fair next year and working out what worked, what didn't work, what people liked, what they didn't like. So they should be going around, and if they're not, they'll be in at the welcome desk. If you could have a look at those. So, okay, so let's see some hands. Put your hand up if you want to talk. So I'll start with you there, one, and then two, and then Pepe, three. So that's three. So.
Yeah, thanks for it. It was really hugely interesting. I have a question about liberalism and the role of Abu Janan in being the leader of the movement. It happens that I travel myself a lot, never been to Rojava, but to the region of Van in southern eastern Turkey. And I've always seen that Ocalan still holds very tightly, still, its leadership remains somehow unchallenged, and at least this is what seems to me. So I was wondering what's your thoughts on this, and whether you have seen maybe some developments. Maybe the events in Rojava have had emancipatory effect in terms of also raising criticism and questioning his leadership.
Okay, I'll take the other two ones and then we'll answer them. I'll get back to Paul.
I suppose, thanks for the talk, Andrew. Right, I had a lot more questions than answers at the end. Cheers for that. I suppose that the Kurdish independence movement for a long time was kind of stifled by the fact that it was easily dismissed as in Turkey as a terrorist thing and suppressed in Iraq and Syria by police states like under Assad and Hussein, and only now it's kind of we've seen an explosion of Kurdish struggle for independence in the kind of complete breakdown of Iraq and Syria. And I suppose like with every independent movement there are various kind of levels of how radical the people fighting for that are. So whereas the PPK would be rather radical and far left, are there aspects, say, within the Kurdish leadership in Iraq who are fighting ISIS or whoever, would be a bit more perhaps not as radical and would be more willing to participate with, say, the United States in, say, a Kurdish state that would possibly take place in the future? My question is to what extent has the woman's liberation, the effects of the women's liberation in these movements, how successful have they taken off in the more conservative aspects of Kurdish resistance?
And Pepe, go back.
Yeah, no, the first thing that I want to kind of give an announcement, because I just received a text first, and is that Latif Saraldan, the comrade from the Kurdish community here that was supposed to come, had a problem, had to take her girl to the hospital in the morning, so that's why he couldn't make it in the end. We have some other comments here, but in the floor, but I wanted to say, just very briefly, is that with every revolution or any rebellion already, or any social transformative process, there's a lot of contradictions. And sometimes anarchists or people with ideologies in general, you know, expect things to go according to the textbook, and that's rarely the case. And I think that the contradictory nature of any social process requires therefore more of our engagement in order to make sure that those elements that feed into a more libertarian project actually take a predominance. And I think that over the last years, the anarchist movement took a very correct approach in relation to the political question. But again, it hasn't been free of a lot of controversies, and we had huge debates around this some years ago. But I really want to take your invitation about forming a proper campaign or a committee or whatever it is of support to the Kurdish revolutionaries, because it is very important. And we have huge issues here in Europe. I mean, 2 years ago, 3 Kurdish activists were killed in Paris, in the very center of civilization, where supposedly modernity starts and all that, you know, and the French state has been absolutely accomplice of the persecution and the murder of these 3 Kurdish activists by Turkish agents. Okay? Even here in Ireland, we've had, in the case of Oslo, we've gone campaigning for Colombia, that the agents of the Colombia state as well as being allowed to operate by the Irish state, by the EU, and so on and so forth. Still, the EU terrorist list is there. And that brings together a lot of revolutionaries, not only the comrades in Kurdistan, but also our comrades in Colombia, and some shameless self-promotion here, but we're going to have a talk at 2 p.m. exactly in this spot about the very contradictory process of struggle as well in Colombia. So it is very important that we take a voice here and that we oppose this attempt to criminalize struggle and to criminalize revolutionaries all over the world. We were told by an Irish government officer once that they weren't very happy with our defense of the right to rebellion, which, by the way, it's inscribed in the preamble of the Human Rights Declaration. Because it seems to go very fast through the preamble. So anyway, just stay up there.
Paul, I'll get back to you.
Sure. Well, the first question, Öcalan, it says we talk about contradictions. One of the contradictions of the Kurdish movement is that the PKK is now feminist because the patriarch Öcalan says we must be. But that's actually a thing, because Pepe talked about the 3 activists who were murdered in Paris in January 2013. One of whom was Sakin Jansis. I talked about who was the OC in Diyarbakir prison, and it was a very important person in the development of the women's wing of the PKK. We still don't know who killed her and why. We have all sorts of suspicions, but I'm not going to pass on gossip about this because it's too important. But nonetheless, that was a huge loss. But the women of the PKK could not have managed to get the Zapatistas' revolutionary law on women on the agenda and the turn, etc., had it not been for the support of Öcalan. So there's a relationship of mutual dependence there, if you like. Because when you're dealing with a society that is so patriarchal as Kurdish society, it's funny, arguing on one line with a Turkish guy, he's going like, "You know, what do you mean they're feminists? This is the most patriarchal society ever." It's like, yes, but this is cause and effect. You know, this is the reason. That because of those conditions, it would have been impossible to get this on the agenda and accepted without his support. Is that a contradiction? Yes, of course, but this is how reality happens. The second question.
May I just follow up?
Sure.
Any change? I mean, Turkey is particular because there has been, you know, this peace process going on. So I mean, when it comes to Turkey, maybe people have been very, very cautious in terms of, you know, criticizing Ocalan because it was him leading the peace process, the negotiation. So what about Rojava? Do you see any change there? Perhaps open, you know, there isn't any opportunity, has any opportunity opened up for, you know, voicing a more critical position, given the events, the specific events of Rojava, which have, you know, been awful because it was a war, but it also... You know, it might have wrote about emancipation as well, and you know, requests of more autonomy. Or
yeah, I mean, the honest answer is I don't know enough to be able to answer your question. I want to find out, but it's going to take more time of me working to earn the money to be able to afford to go over and spend time there and so on. You know how it is. So, my experience of the Nowruz Festival in Diyarbakir was I was very impressed by the number of women there and the confidence that they had in a way that I hadn't really seen in the Middle East before, you know. And that gave me hope that as precarious as this development is, that it is gathering momentum and gathering strength. And that's all I can say, really. So, sorry. So to get on to the second question. You mentioned the T word, the terrorist word. That's actually worth saying something about. In Ireland, we're, for historical reasons, we're used to accepting the division between the military wing and the political wing, in the sense that, you know, we accept that there's an IRA and there's a Sinn Féin, and that you don't lock people up because they're a member of Sinn Féin. In Turkey, this is completely not accepted. So the PKK is actually the political wing, right? The HBG is the armed wing. But in practice, they go, okay, PKK is the HBG, is a terrorist organization. Now, in 2004, the organizational aspect of the launching of the democratic and federalism was the creation of what was initially called the KKK, and then they realized that was probably a bad name. And they changed to the KCK, which is the Confederation or the Union of Kurdish Communities, which is a pan-Kurdistan entity, which in the sense that it involves people in Turkey, in Syria, in Iraq, and Iran. And that, again, no sooner had it been formed than, of course, the Kurdish state stepped in and arrested everybody. And particularly, you know, the intellectuals, the academics, then they got their lawyers, then they arrested the lawyers. And, you know, so literally, again, they arrested 3,000 people because, again, they will not, even though the KCK is clearly a civilian political organization, it's just not accepted in Turkey and everywhere else in the region. It's basically, if you have anything to do with any kind of organized form, no matter how civilian you make it, you're a terrorist, bang, gotcha. So it's, you have to understand, it's very difficult operating under these conditions of repression, make it very difficult. For example, you know, in this country it would be fine to ask if someone is a member of the Sinn Féin. But because of the criminalization, it's a lot more difficult. You know, it would be bad etiquette to be asking someone if they're a member of the PKK or KCK or whatever, because these are officially illegal organizations, even if they are political organizations. So that's important to remember. The effect of the democratic confederalism, democratic autonomy term of the KCK in relation to parties in the Kurdish regional government in northern Iraq, which is Barzani's KDP and Taliban's PUK. You have to understand in relation to the KDP and the PUK, these are much more traditional tribal structures, in the sense that Barzani is a tribal chief and his party is, you know, his tribal army, and Talibani the same. He takes care of the people that speak Sorani, Barzani, that's the Kurmanji speak in northern, people in northern Iraq. So they have zero interest in challenging tribal structures because this is what they are. You know what I mean? It's not possible for them to even think about it, you know? And, you know, anything, obviously anything coming from the direction of KK, they consider an existential threat anyhow. So yeah, they're completely opposed. I mean, that's the short answer, and I don't think it's more complicated than that, really. Yeah, in relation to what Pere said, in terms of contradictions, absolutely, you have to understand this is not a small but perfectly formed ideological organization of 12 people. This is a mass movement of millions of people. I don't mean that there are millions of people that are formally members, but I mean there are millions of people that are in some way involved. And obviously within such a large number of people, there are a great number of different political viewpoints, you know. You know, there's a left wing, there's a right wing, there's people in the center, there's all kinds of different things. There's people who are atheists, there's people who are devout Muslims, there's people who are, you know, all sorts of things going on here. So, for sure, you know, when you have a movement for social change within a society that is experiencing extreme social extreme repression to start with, but then also extreme social tensions as well, there's a whole world of contradictions going on at the same time. So it's not surprising that the contradictions are there. What in some ways what's surprising is that anything is happening at all, because you know the conditions are so difficult. And I think this is something that Andrew said at the previous time we were talking about the Rojava revolution. Is like, it's that old Irish joke, you ask someone how to get to such a place and they go like, well, if I wanted to go there, I wouldn't start from here. If I wanted to make a revolution, I wouldn't want to do it in the middle of a civil war where you're being attacked on one side by lunatic fucking maniac sectarian fanatics on one side and then backed by an extremely hostile fascistic state controlling your border on the other side, under conditions of complete lockdown and barricade. You know, of all the places to create a social utopia, this is probably not a great place. But the fact is, historically, if you look at where revolutions happen, they never happen in easy places. Revolutions always happen under conditions of stress, extreme stress. And that, again, is why what's happening in Rojava is so inspiring, because despite the extreme stress, they are making bold, radical experiments. Now, they may fail. There is no guarantee of success when you're trying something new, when you're experimenting, when you're trying to find a new way to produce, to live, to reproduce, and to be. But the fact of the attempt itself is inspiring and something we should pay attention to.
Okay, so more small questions. Okay, so I'll take a little this time. So 1, 2, and 3. And can you keep them quite short? Because the shorter you are, the more people will get to go in.
And, two questions, one bigger question, and one kind of just slight question. First question being that just looking around the internet and various media sources on the left, there's kind of divided support for Rojava. Some people are very excited, especially with the libertarian and directly democratic content of what's going on in the three cantons, and other people who are more of a more traditional Marxist / class struggleist perspective tend to look at it more critically. They're saying, oh, it's not explicitly oriented around class struggle. They make an enormous deal about the fact that the PKK in Turkey asked Kurds to not participate in the second of two general strikes as they were negotiating with the Turkish government at the time. They said, oh, you see, they're putting their national interests over class interests. They're still nationalists, they're still nationalizationists, they haven't changed, and so on. But I guess just maybe to answer some of those criticisms, could you talk a little bit about the class structure of the three cantons, specifically how the economy works. Like, a lot of us know about how the political structure has been set up. It's the democratic confederalism, where it's directly democratic assemblies at the bottom and confederated structures with mandated delegates going out. That's the political side. Just to tackle the economic side. The other just very brief question is, we know, of course, a lot about the women question in Rojava. Also, what about the status of LGBT people? Just some comments on that, perhaps, more information.
First of all, thank you for an extremely illuminative talk. I'm not involved in the anarchist movement at all. I'm still probably wedded to the train track neo-theorist conception of history you mentioned earlier. So I ask this with some trepidation. I was wondering, because you're talking about how the Kurds have historically been deployed as a colonialist plaything and pawns, effectively, in games involving economic acquisition and exploitation, what the general opinion of Western military intervention is. I was talking to Richard Boyd Barrett not that long ago, and he mentioned that photograph taken in Aleppo of a sign that said that was the misattributed quote from Einstein, stupidity is doing the same thing twice, expecting a different conclusion in response to the airstrikes. And I would have until recently taken the view that intervention should be minimal, it should be confined to arming and sending military advisors and synchronizing air power with the movements of insurgents on the ground.
That's a minute, so.
Oh, yeah, sorry. That's the question. Kurdish socialist rebel militias. And I just want to know, do they think it's an unwarranted colonialist inversion?
Maybe we'll leave it at that question.
Okay.
It's hard to stop sometimes, so I'll take you very quickly.
Ramadi, ISIS took over the whole year, how did these societies shape? I remember looking at some Kurdish Arabic, they said young people of Ali, follows ISIS, didn't write in English, and it wasn't trying to attract attention to the West, you see. There's had to be a serious liberal change in the political part of the Kurdish, like in Western, the fact that Ali is there for so long. So that's the end of the question.
Nice one. I like it.
What was the question?
So what's your question again?
That's a sort of change to the place, but in parts of Kurdistan, but also other parts of Iraq, such as Bali. Bali has had it for so long.
So you want to know, has the similar things happened in other parts of Iraq. Okay,
I'm
going to take Cueve at the back and then.
It's not a question, Paul. Do you mind?
Go for it.
Okay. I thought it was super comprehensive, but there was just a couple of points that maybe contest is the wrong word, but I thought the framing of the reference to the Kurdish movement sort of using imagery and social media that fetishized their own movement and women's participation in their movement, which is a huge part of their movement, was slightly inaccurate. I think it was more there was a fetishization in Western media and amongst our networks of promoting images which were a very accurate reflection of a reality, which is an intergenerational reality. And the fact that maybe people copped onto it now is our problem, but I don't think that was a strategy of activism movement. Second, I'd say that the sort of contrast, of people critiquing, sort of Islamophobia or Orientalism, sort of as if they're a dichotomy, is a critique, that has existed in the left in the Arab world for a very long time. It's just we've chosen not to listen to that. And it's not really Orientalism, I think it's cultural relativism in the sense that people still lack an understanding that we can resist and reject Islamophobia in our context while also having a very strong tradition of backing our comrades in an Arab world context in Turkey and in the region in their opposition to right-wing currents of political Islam. And finally, I'd just say in the sense of a Turkish context, in terms of a categorization, you know, of a blanket sort of criminalization of the Kurdish movement, that despite that, that there are very strong political movements, such as the HDP, which have a very real possibility of gaining, you know, a percentage significant enough to participate in the parliamentary process, but that post-Gezi Park, that there has been a shift in consciousness to a certain degree within the Turkish left, really challenging a very xenophobic neo-nationalism and expressing overt solidarity for the Kurdish movement. So I think that's shifting within Turkey. But I really, just to go back to the point that you ended on, Paul, I think that within the Kurdish movement, within the feminisms within the Kurdish movement, that we have to learn. And I think it's also important, you know, in terms of our framing of what we're translating from what we witnessed, that this is a subjective lens, but that there is a very nuanced, multi-layered discourse and analysis within women within the Kurdish movement and within movements in the region in general. And those, as well as our witnesses of going there, you know, for periods of time and witnessing those, but those are the voices that we have to be prioritizing and building platforms for.
I'll get back to Paul. That's probably your closing comments as well, because we're running out of time.
Yeah. In relation to what Owen said about the various critics from the Officer Bar Brady Move Along, There's Nothing to See Here section of our movement, which exists. The thing about them calling off participation in the strike is correct, and but more importantly, they initially attempted, because of being in these peace process talks with the AKP and the Turkish government, they initially attempted to stop their activists going to Gezi Park. And essentially the activists in Istanbul said, well, no, fuck you, this is important. And so they kind of broke the party line, if you like. This is what I'm saying about, you know, this is a mass movement here. There are contradictions within it. You know, there is an executive council and a leadership, and then there are the activists that cater on the street, and they don't always agree. And Gezi Park, I think, was an important example where the activists on the street decided to take their own initiative and do something different. And Gezi, I think, as Cuiva already mentioned, Gezi has really had a huge effect on transforming politics in Turkey, which is a whole other topic that we haven't really had time to talk about, and sadly our comrade from Istanbul, Hussein, is not here because he could tell you lots about it. But it has also had its impact on reinforcing in many ways the people within the KCK who are championing the democratic alternative turn. And within that, women's rights and LGBT rights as well. So Gezi has had an important reinforcing aspect in terms of opening up the possibility for change within Turkey. The fact that it has alienated, it's divided Turkish society in such a way that the Kurds now have certain possibilities for alliances with Alevis and liberals and other people who are alienated by Erdogan's relentless quest for power. And the HDP that Cuiva mentioned is an outcome of that, which is essentially the BDP, which would have been the political wing of the Kurdish movement, in alliance with leftist Alevis in Western Turkey and so on, and they have a possibility in the coming election, if the polls are to be believed, to break this 10% barrage. The Turkish state has set a boundary whereas you have to win 10% of the electoral vote in order to be represented in parliament at all. You know, other countries have maybe 3%, 5%, so on. It's set at 10% deliberately to try and exclude the Kurds. That's the only reason it's 10%. However, because of Gezi, because of these shifting alliances, there's a possibility now that they will break through this 11%. And that matters because, I'm sorry, we're getting into Turkish politics. That matters because it would deprive Erdogan of his 400 AKP MPs that he needs to be crowned the new Sultan. So he's getting very upset about that. But it also means that he's banging the very nationalist drum at the moment, and things are getting very difficult, to say the least. Sorry, get distracted on that. So class, economy, Kobane, again, yes, good point. Of course, like I said, you know, the majority of Kurds are proletarian, same as anybody else. And Kobane and is areas that have been deliberately underdeveloped by the Syrian state. So, you know, they grow the grain, but they don't have proper mills there. They have oil, but they don't have refineries there and so on. So people are having to improvise means of turning the crude oil into some kind of usable diesel for fuel and stuff like that. So they're taking, like I mentioned before, about the taking control of the land of the absentee landlords who have fled since 2012. They are taking control of the economy because, of course, they need to feed themselves and fuel themselves. Last week, the YPG managed to capture a big concrete manufacturing plant, which is good because I've been down to Kobane, and believe me, American intervention waited until ISIS was in the city. So they said, we will let you keep Kobane, but we're going to reduce it to fucking rubble first. So you can have it, but you can build your utopia on a field of rubble. So Kobane is a mess. There's only about a third of the city now, which is even halfway habitable. In terms of the economy there, at the moment, there is a bakery running, which is providing bread for, you know, five of your Kurdish loaves of bread per person per day. This is free. There is a store, because all the shops are destroyed or closed or ruined. There is a depot where the stuff that they managed to get in is distributed to people, shared evenly for free. At the moment, there is a moneyless economy in Kobane, but this is because it's a war zone, so this is a form of disaster communism, if you like. The important thing will be to see what happens. They try to move from that position of disaster, which is being supported, of course, by support from Kurds in Turkey and so on, donating food and medical supplies and so on. When they move to that to start getting agriculture going back again and so on, it will be interesting to see what happens. U.S. intervention, yes, as I say, a bit of a double-edged sword in the sense that they could have bombed ISIS on the outskirts of Kobane, but they found it more convenient to reduce the city to rubble instead. So they got what they wanted without giving too much away. Contradictions in relation to U.S. intervention, of course, because, you know, it can turn off at any time. I don't know, it's, you know, it's to be discussed. Kweeva's question in relation to the pictures of the cute girls with the guns is not cynical marketing by the movement, is like, we've imposed that frame on it. Yes, perhaps. I don't know.
Can I just give your voice?
Avoiding the trap of cultural relativism, absolutely. This is, as I said before, we have to make an effort to think outside of what we know, to be have an open mind, to be prepared to learn, to be able to accept difference without othering it or essentializing it or fetishizing it in some way. So yes, I think it's very important that we continue to learn, to ask questions, and to spread the answers that we find around. But I think there's definitely interesting thing happening in terms of particularly what the feminist side of the movement is doing and attempting to do, which has wider implications, not just for Kurdish society, but also for Arab society, for Turkish society, for Middle Eastern society, and even our own societies as well. Here, our own. Not the Eurocentrism. I think I've more or less got everything
there. That's a good
there.
Spot to end. Thanks very much for talking to me.